Wrestling fans, and welcome to Mid-South Wrestling Television Network. I'm your host, Boyd Pearson. We have a lot of exciting action coming up for you. Tag team action sends popular stars Mr. Olympia and Chavo Guerrero as partners. Also, Mr. Wrestling 2, the new Mississippi heavyweight champion, having won that title on November the 27th in the Jackson Coliseum in Jackson, Mississippi. Stagger Lee, the new North American heavyweight title holder. He gained the crown at the Superdome on Thursday night, November the 25th. Also, Ted DiBiase and Matt Bourne, the Mid-South Tag Team Champions, are here. Mr. USA, Tony Atlas from Roanoke, Virginia. Gorgeous Gino Hernandez. A lot of great action because they're all top stars. And talking about top stars, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to tell you about a man that's a successful promoter in Houston, Texas, the fourth largest city in the United States, in the arena and outside of the arena. He's great and known everywhere for his charitable activities to such groups as the Boys Clubs, the Rotary Clubs, and all the others. Besides that, he's the dean of professional wrestling announcer, 34 consecutive years, never missing a week on television. That means only one man. That's Mr. Paul Bosch. Paul, our guest commentator, welcome.
Thank you, Boyd. And I do have some trouble. I can't get this earphone over my cauliflower ear. I don't have that trouble because I don't wear them in my program. Maybe that's why I stayed on for 34 years. But we are going to have action tonight, and certainly in Mid-South, action is busting out all over the place. Recently affiliated with Mid-South, Houston is well pleased with all of the things that come from the Mid-South area, and we think you people are pretty lucky, and our association is going to be a fruitful one for the fans, particularly because some of the wrestling talent here cannot be equaled any place else in the world, and that was the reason for our affiliation at the time.
And as our guest commentator, we're looking forward to your articulate commentary coming up. But earlier, Paul Bosch had an interview with Hacksaw Jim Duggan referring to the Brass Knucks Championship. Let's watch that right now.
Here at ringside with Hacksaw Duggan. Now that's Duggan with two G's and one belt.
Yes, sir, that's right. And Paul, I'm glad you're out here today because I understand that you're an inventor of something that I would very much like to have. Though I do have this nice, shiny Louisiana State Wrestling Championship belt, I actually feel kind of bare. I feel like I need something over the shoulder, something that really amplifies Hacksaw Duggan and Hacksaw Duggan's wrestling style. And I understand that you're the man who first brought out the Brass Knuckles Championship. And as long as I've been here in Louisiana, I buy these nice fancy damn programs. I open it up and there's Cowboy Bill Watts as a Brass Knuckles Champion.
Well, Cowboy Bill Watts won the Brass Knuckles Championship and he held it until he retired from the ring.
I understand that. I understand that he defended it very well. He was a rough and tough guy, my type of guy that I like. That's why I want the belt reinstated. That's why Hacksaw Duggan wants a shot at that belt. Bring that belt out of retirement. Bring Cowboy Bill Watts out of retirement. Bring somebody out of retirement. Bring Hacksaw Duggan that brass knuckles belt that he much deservedly belongs to him more than anyone else here in Mid-South. Now, excuse me, now I got to talk about this Tony Atlas, who's going to take me out in the ring and a championship.
And that's about all the time you have right now to talk.
Well, I may have given Hacksaw Duggan a short answer, but the truth of the matter is that the Brass Knucks title was invented to signify the toughest wrestler in the world. He
right
could
now,
qualify.
Right now, Paul, Hacksaw Duggan is in the ring. Let's go for the introduction of the opening match.
This is a non-title event for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 270 pounds from New York City, the Louisiana heavyweight champion, Hacksaw Duggan. And in the blue corner at 238 pounds from Kingston, Jamaica, Lester Park.
The introduction of this event, Louisiana heavyweight title holder Hacksaw Jim Duggan versus newcomer from Jamaica, Lester Parks. Referee Alfred Neely handing the belt to the outside man because this is a non-title match, called for the bell. Here's Paul Bosch.
Yes, and there is Hacksaw Duggan. And Duggan, who attempts to prove that he is the toughest man in the wrestling world every time he steps out, may be learning to count by the way he stomps his foot in the ring, and there are some people who say that, but usually it charges his batteries and he goes after his man after he does that stomping. Here now, as he goes behind Lester Parks. He tries to keep him on his knees, tries to tie him up and keep him in a defensive position. Duggan trying for the pin, didn't quite make it. Now, as he cuts off like Duggan generally does, those hard and telling and exhausting elbow blows, the forearm smash to the back, can always find a sensitive spot. Parks is in trouble because Duggan, who doesn't like to start off any program, he thinks he's a finisher, can take it in the midsection and he can dish it out at any part of the body. As a football player, he had the same insatiable desire to try to knock somebody's head off, and that accounted for a shortened career in football, but it probably could account for a lengthy career in wrestling. The crotch hold, the lift, and Duggan with his slam, and he made sure that the slam went where he wanted it to go. Watch him now as he gets into that football stance. It's one of the things that he uses, and again, he almost knocked Parks' head off with what he calls and we call the spear, and the spear did it, Boyd Pierce. The spear did it.
And Hacksaw Duggan with his hand raised in victory. We'll be back when action returns after this message from Mid-South Wrestling.
This is a non-title event for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 245 pounds from St. Joseph, Missouri, Mike Bond. And in the blue corner at 236 pounds from Atlanta, Georgia, the Mississippi heavyweight champion, Mr. Wrestling 2.
And in the red tights, Mike Bond against the popular star, as you see him now rolling up his white and black trim robe, Mr. Wrestling 2. Paul Bosch, you heard him being brought on by the 2-2-2-2-2-2.
I tell you, every arena in the country knows that 2-2-2 signal wherever Mr. Wrestling 2 goes, and that unique style of his that is probably an exasperation to most of the people whom he defeats. But as he sees it, it's an encouragement to him. He is different from other people. He's having a tough time right now because he is being vandalized in a strange way. Markings all over his equipment. His masks have been desecrated with a yellow streak by somebody who evidently has a yellow streak, because Wrestling 2 has tried to entice the man or woman or person who is doing the vandalizing and using graffiti on his equipment to come forward, but none of them would. When he protected his own masks, they used facsimiles of his mask and wrote nasty things on them. So two right now has a problem. Somebody's trying to use a little psychology on him, and of course it could revert to a reverse psychology. Two now caught with a shoulder butt, and Mike comes in there. And, oh, that is what you call a bad landing. He landed hard on his hips, and as he starts to get up, he is caught in that front headlock. Note that the arm is in there. That denotes that this is a legal hold. It's not a chokehold because of the presence of the arm. And all of the efforts of Mike Bond devoted to keeping his distance from number two and finding a way to counter. There's a sit out, but notice too, he squirmed right around there and blocked the sit up by out by changing his balance. And as two hangs on tenaciously, it's part of the bulldog manner that has made him one of the great stars of the wrestling world. And as Mike again tried that crotch hold and that roll to shake loose, and notice how he's trying to shake loose. He has used a variety of escapes, none of which have actually succeeded for him. This is the kind of a hold that Mr. Wrestling 2 and use on the biggest of wrestlers, big men, like Kamala, the Ugandan giant, for instance, would have a tough time getting out of a hold like this, because this is something that the masked man has perfected as a basis of his own style, and he makes good use of it in every match in which he wrestles. Somebody has to expend a lot of energy in order to get out of it, and it leaves Mr. Wrestling 2 a lot fresher than his opponent after the hold.
And Paul, talking about the plaudits and the credential on Mr. Wrestling 2 on Saturday night, November the 27th, in Jackson, Mississippi, at the Jackson Coliseum, Mr. Wrestling 2 became the new Mississippi heavyweight champion in a grueling, hard-fought scientific contest against Mr. Olympia. He was a victor and is the new champion of the state of Mississippi.
Well, I'll tell you, Mr. Wrestling 2 is a man who, without a belt, is a champion in the opinion of many people because of the manner in which he conducts himself outside of the ring, and most certainly the things that he does in the ring, which are a credit to the game and which please his coterie of fans no end. And that is just about everybody in the wrestling world. Still that front headlock, and as he racks this man around the ring, he stretches him out, but he has not yet gotten him down to the point of exhausting him. And again, as he noticed the swift, rough, rugged manner in which he snatched that hold, and as much as to say, you got out once, but you're not getting out this time. And he pours it to Mike Bond. New approach now for number two. Up and over, and a hard drop. Watch him. He's looking for the angle so he can throw that knee lift in there. And the knee lift is not a new hold. What is new is the manner in which wrestling number two uses it, the timing he uses, the lightning with which he strikes, and the way that fans love it. 2-2-2.
And two is the winner. And we'll be back after this message from Mid-South Wrestling Television Network. Stagger Lee, the new North American heavyweight champion, will be in action in our next match. But earlier, our guest commentator, Paul Bosch, talked with Ted DiBiase and Matt Bourne, and the center of controversy on that interview was Stagger Lee, Paul. Right?
Is it Stagger Lee or JYD? Ted DiBiase has his own ideas.
All right, let's watch and listen to what they had to say.
With me at ringside and devoid of belts, Ted DiBiase and Matt Bourne. And Ted, you have something to say about that.
The reason I'm here, Mr. Bosch, is because I want to talk about the North American heavyweight title, of which I was not beaten, I was robbed of. I was assured that if I took the mask off of Stagger Lee, and it was in fact the Junkyard Dog, that he would be suspended not for 90 days, but no less than 1 year. I did this. I took the mask off of him. It was in fact the Junkyard Dog. There was press at ringside taking pictures. All of a sudden, I can't find a photographer. I can't find one picture of the Junkyard Dog. Matchmaker Grizzly Smith says, I didn't happen to see that match. Now, have you ever known Grizzly Smith to miss a major title match? No. And Boyd Pierce, the voice of Mid-South Wrestling, was at ringside, got up and turned his back and said he didn't see it. And he was right there.
My word doesn't seem to be any good, though.
Now. The reason I'm bringing this to your attention, Mr. Bosch, is because I know that you are a fair man. You dealt with my father in the past, and I want a rematch. I want the chance to prove this again, and I know if I can get him in the ring, I can prove it again, that it is, in fact, the Junkyard Dog. If I can get this match in Houston, Texas, I know that you would be unbiased and would deal with it fairly, and justice would be served.
Well, it just depends. We'll see what we can do about it.
Paul Bosch. As you'll learn, you've known me through the years, the people in the Mid-South area watching know that I tell it just like it is. I was in the Superdome on Thanksgiving evening. I was at ringside during that championship match, as Ted DiBiase said, between he and Stagger Lee. But I did not see who Stagger Lee was, because when the unmasking started, I turned my back talking to the policeman because I don't have the time to be a star witness before Mr. Charlie Lay, the president of the Mid-South Wrestling. And when I turned around to the ring, the count was 1-2-3, and the winner was Stagger Lee, who is a new North American heavyweight champion. Right now, let's go to the ring for the introduction of the next match.
And this is a non-title event for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 250 pounds from Rome, Georgia, Marty Lundy.
And
And at 265 pounds, the North American heavyweight champion, Stagger Lee.
That was the introduction of the new North American heavyweight title holder, Stagger Lee, against the black trunk-clad Marty Lundy. Alfred Neely calls for the bell. Here's Paul.
Yes, and the question of whether it's Stagger Lee or JYD is written on the T-shirt worn by Stagger Lee. Stagger Lee transferred the stagger to Martin Lundy, and he caught him with that clothesline coming off the rope that time, and here is a mighty rugged individual. On top, Stagger Lee, and out from underneath comes Marty Lundy. He is caught now in a reverse chin lock, and his chin is nestled in the crook of the powerful arm of Stagger Lee. And now as the hold changes, you can see that Stagger Lee is trying to keep it in there, and he changes tactics. A driving headbutt, and there's a lot of difference in the amount of pressure and the place where it's applied. He caught him with a forearm that was solid and shattering that time. Again, Stagger Lee trying to pour it on to Marty Lundy, and this time Marty Lundy does not get out. He does not get up, and Stagger Lee showing that violent temper of his leaves the ring.
And we'll have tag team action coming up after this message from Mid-South.
It's tag team action now in a non-title event for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner, the Mid-South Tag Team Champions at 268 pounds from Omaha, Nebraska, Ted DiBiase. And his partner at 240 pounds from Atlanta, Georgia, Matt Bourne. In the blue corner at 222 pounds from Knoxville, Tennessee, Tim Horner. And his partner at 238 pounds from Richmond, Virginia, Buddy Landell.
And the fans cheer the introduction of these two popular young stars, Tim Horner and Buddy Landell, as they go against the rugged duo, who are also the Mid-South Tag Team Champions, Ted DiBiase and Matt Bourne. Is Horner against Bourne in the ring? Here's Paul.
Yes, and Horner is up against a tough one, but so is Bourne. Now, these two youngsters here have a great opportunity to upset Bourne and DiBiase, and nothing would please these fans more. In behind was Horner, a proper place to be. The arm roll by Tony Bourne's son, Matt, was the proper answer, but you saw the way Tim Horner turned that to his own advantage. Now, look at this boy, Landell, and you'd be hard to find a finer-looking young athlete than Buddy Landell. He's a man who knows his way around the ring. But as he goes in to try it on Tony Bourne, let's see what occurs. Oh, that was a neat sidestep, and he took Bourne right along with him. Bourne fell into the rhythm of just what Buddy Landell was trying to do, and Tony squirms for the outside of that ring to think it over. He knows that what happened to him just now is a sign of the ability of the opposing team, and particularly of Buddy Landell. But there are tough customers in that corner. Ted DiBiase and Matt Bourne, both sons of wrestlers. Both have been wrestling since they were old enough to walk, and they wrestle by instinct rather than by training. Ted DiBiase looking for the opportunity, and as he moves in, he gets a tried for a sunset flip. He didn't get it, and DiBiase underneath was bouncing almost frantically in order to keep his shoulders from touching the mat, and that drop kick convinced him that it was time to hit on the outside of the ring. And listen to those fans as they really get on Ted DiBiase for avoiding punishment by stepping outside the ring. And they're telling him it's Stagger Lee, not JYD. All of the fans are very, very willing to back the assumption that the man under the mask, the man that that Ted DiBiase calls the junkyard dog, is really Stagger Lee, the nemesis of JYD's youth. side headlock now, but the Ted DiBiase breaks, and there is a quick switch. Oh, he almost caught one in the face. But he, by his instinct alone, he got out of the way, and here is Tim Horner tossing both of them around here like a pair of sacks, and I can tell you this, that the confusion that exists between Ted DiBiase and Tony Bourne is a reflection of the fact that tragedy has struck their willingness to wrestle, and they're bragging about having all of the belts tied up. We have seen the belts here tonight on different people. Stagger Lee particularly holding a belt that has gotten Ted DiBiase in a bad frame of mind. So side headlock, and as DiBiase stepped out of the way, it was Bourne who caught it, and we may have the atomic drop. No, we've got a touch. The atomic drop, and it worked. He's off the second rope, and again, the hard driving projectile of Ted DiBiase struck Buddy Landell in the place where you can't grow much muscle, right at the base of the skull, and it's got him a little bit dazed over the next step to take here to protect himself from punishment and to resume the spot that he and his partner had just a short time ago when they were riding high by bouncing the opposition around. Bourne comes in willingly. He senses that Buddy Landell is ripe for plucking. Ooh, what a nasty way to flatten a man's nose. There may not be any good ways, but that's one of the nastiest. And from underneath comes Buddy Landell with a quick prone press. He's got a reverse chin lock caught on him right now. That knee of Matt Bourne is right in the back of Buddy Landell. It was the key to the hold, and as Buddy managed to squirm around, Matt lost some of the effectiveness of the grip. So Buddy Landell, he's close to the corner. He should touch out. He did not. And notice the quick move that Matt Bourne made to switch him away from where that long arm of his might have reached out and touched. Two tough teams, two well-working teams. They are pooling their cooperation, particularly among Horner and Landell. Now with Ted DiBiase in there, he takes over with a vengeance. I think he's taking out some of his frustrations on the fortunes of war by trying to punish Buddy Landell. Two and close. Buddy, Tim Horner is more than anxious to come in. He is leaning over that rope and trying to touch, but that rope is tall and it's hard to gain any inches. So they've captured Buddy Landell in the corner, and both Bourne and DiBiase are capable of knocking the starch out of any individual in the game when they double up on him. And there was two. He almost got the three. And as Buddy Landell tries to reach across that ring, in comes DiBiase to try to flatten Buddy Landell into that canvas. Caught him well, and there's a touch, and in comes Tim Horner, and he is ready to start swinging, and he does. A lot of life left in this match, and a lot of life left in the two youngsters who are trying that. And again, Tim Horner comes in there with a body slam, and a drop kick that spells an outside the ring for Tony Bourne's son, Matt. Oh, there was a hard smash that time. Each of them going in opposite directions, meeting head on that way. You got Tim Horner down, and in comes Buddy Landell. And Landell starts to get after Bourne, and the referee, he's up on the top rope.
He's coming off the top rope here in the Mid-South. That is a disqualification automatically off the top rope, caught by the official's eye, because he was conned away across the way.
He was not seen by the official. He was seen by all these fans and will be seen by our television audience, but Matt Bourne got away with it. But the rule states if he is caught by the referee, there's the bell. And that figure four leg lock, that leg breaker, was applied by Ted DiBiase, and I don't think he had to do that because Tim Horner had been belted by that illegal drop off the top rope.
Exactly. And the Mid-South Tag Team Champions Matt Bourne and Ted DiBiase hand raised in victory. We'll be back. Mr. USA Tony Atlas in action after this message.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner, at 295 pounds from Houston, Texas, Tug Taylor. And in the blue corner at 252 pounds from Roanoke, Virginia, Mr. USA Tony Atlas.
And you'll see the big bulkness now of Tug Taylor against the massiveness, muscular form from Roanoke, Virginia of Mr. USA Tony Atlas.
Well, here is a contrast in shape in more ways than one, because Tug Taylor is a throwback to the old wrestlers of the 1920s whose barrel girth was the big part of their strength. And in Tony Atlas, one of the most magnificent athletes you're going to see in many a day's walk, is going here to demonstrate the fact that the modern athlete believes in muscle as beauty as well as muscle that is functional. And any man that can prone press 550 or 600 pounds is a man who is going to be reckoned with a lot of sincerity. In all the 50 years I put in wrestling, I think Tony Atlas is the best built wrestler I have ever seen, possibly the strongest wrestler I have ever seen. He's fortunate, Tony is fortunate in the fact that he not only has strength against inanimate objects like weights, but he has strength man to man, and there is a lot of difference because it depends on balance, it depends on timing, and it depends on practice to, whoops! Well, that's one good way to treat the girth of Mr. Tug Taylor. But Tony has the attributes that make an athlete in any sport, and the willingness to get in there and to pitch. Standing arm lock as Tug Taylor now pulls Tony's arm down close to the sides, but he is not reckoning with the fact that he has 22-inch biceps. And Tug Taylor, even with his well-balanced and well-centered weight, couldn't hold him. Twisting arm lock. And Atlas puts another screw in the hold, another turn, and you can just trace it up the arm as the tricep muscle starts to come out on top instead of underneath. Tug Taylor looking for the jaw, found it, and Tony gets a little bit upset at what happened because, like most people, he doesn't like to be hit in the face. Few people do. And here he is now trying to teach Tug Taylor a lesson in ring manners. And Tug Taylor avoided it. A smart move, says Taylor, and a smarter move, says Tony Atlas. He caught the tug and tugged him into the ring. And as Tony now tries to set Tug Taylor up, he's looking for it, and he racked him in there. Monkey flip. And I want to tell you, that's the wrong way to land. When you get a three-point landing like that, it's going to go up and down your spine in a way that you're going to feel for days. So Tug Taylor moves in, attempt at a flying mare, and Tony, with sheer strength, put a stop to it. And with his clap on the whiskers, is able to convince him that things are still going to happen. Now Tony, with that double-barreled wallop of his, something he likes to do. Crotch hold, and he's going to try to lift him up in the air, something that is pretty nearly impossible. It was only half impossible because he got him up far enough to be able to turn him over and drop him down on the mat. And here is Tony Atlas with the driving headbutt and the big splash, and oh, how he splashed on that Tug Taylor. Tony Atlas.
Tony Atlas proving that he's tops in muscular condition and also tops in the professional wrestling with a victory. More action continues after this word.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 235 pounds from Houston, Texas, gorgeous Gino Hernandez. And in the blue corner at 222 pounds, also from Houston, Tony Torres.
Battle of the Houstonians now. Tony Torres and his opponent, the self-proclaimed gorgeous man of wrestling, gorgeous Gino Hernandez. Paul?
Well, Boyd, I want to tell you, having watched the budding of gorgeous Gino's career for 7 years, he could adopt a new nickname because he is as tough as any man you'll find in the ring. In spite of the fact that most people don't like him, they don't like his tactics, he goes ahead winning and he goes ahead providing action in that ring every time he steps in there. It's probably the most charitable thing I can say about him because he doesn't like me and I don't get along well with him, but we'll try to give him an honest count on this occasion here at Mid-South. Crotch hold and slam. The Tony Torres is a fine young athlete and a man who, when he gains more weight, is going to be heard from in the wrestling game. And right now, as he avoids gorgeous Gino's efforts to tie him up, Gino comes up with a front headlock. And as we saw in a previous match, the wrestling number two used that same hold and held on to it and held on to it. Tony was able to get out. Mule kick. He swung around that time with the back of his foot and the heel and caught him right in the midsection. Gino on top again, but as he tries now to cover the squirming and difficult to handle Tony Torres, the hold is a reverse chin lock. Tony is close to the ropes, but he is not making use of the ropes, and the arm flying mare got him out of trouble and back into trouble. So Gino shows his versatility by first grabbing him by the head and keeping him in problem territory, and then when he lost his hold, snatching that leg and applying a grip on the foot. And Gino has used more holds in this match than he has used in some of his longer matches in Houston. But people in Houston irritate Gino to the point that he rarely wrestles with a great deal of discretion. In this case, he is hanging on to a figure four leg lock. He was hanging on to it when I made the statement. He's back after it to try to cover up Tony Torres. And as Tony wobbles from side to side, he looks for the front headlock for the same purpose that two used it, that Gino used it, that any wrestler uses it, to wear him down and to try to put him into a position where Gino would have had to release that grip. So the referee calls for the break, and as Tony gets up, he gets up a little limpingly and a little haltingly and squirms right after Tony Torres to put him in the same predicament. Spinning toe hold, keeps that grip that leg wrapped around his own and puts the pressure on the ankle. And this, a little difficult to counter, almost impossible to not suffer injury from it. And now as Gino comes back in, he changes the hold but doesn't change the leg, which is an indication of his wrestling savvy, because if one isn't working and he knows he has done some damage on that leg, he changes the point of leverage and pours it to him. So Tony's in trouble as gorgeous Gino drops in there, this time raising a Charlie horse on the inside of the thigh of Tony Torres. Tony's close to the ropes, and as he tries now, oh, he smashed that right across Gino's face, and it was his good leg. Gino was working on the other one, but he came down there hard, and that gorgeous face of Gino's, something that he worries about constantly, took the blow. And Tony Torres caught in a head scissor, and Gino again gets into that position where he can lord it over his opponent, but he'd best watch out. Tony's moving into an escape position and may be able to. He did. He just used the leverage of his body to get out of there. So the exchanges are happening, and gorgeous Gino is trying to cut Tony Torres down to size. On top, close, and as he sets him up. Gino come up there with a drop kick. He's on top. We got a one and a two, but we do not have the three, and that's the important number when you're tolling that count as a referee. Gino now looking for a back body drop, and he got it. Up on the rope comes Gino off to take that reverse chop at the chest and throat of Tony Torres, and Hernandez weighed along with it, and Gino Hernandez takes the fall.
And continues his victory. Skeen, we have time left. The next match, two popular stars are partners in tag team action, Chavo Guerrero and Mr. Olympia. We'll view it after this important message from Mid-South.
It's tag team action now for one fall or remaining television time. In the red corner, at a total combined weight of 513 pounds, from Fort Worth, Texas, the Davidson brothers, John and Rick Davidson. And in the blue corner, at 243 pounds, Mr. Olympia. And his partner, at 235 pounds, from Mexico, Chavo Guerrero.
Alfred Neely called for the bell, Paul.
Well,
Chavo Guerrero.
We've got things breaking loose all over the ring there before the bell started. And we've got Chavo Guerrero and Mr. Olympia returning the compliment to the Davidson brothers who started the action. And the masked man and his Mexican partner put a stop to it in a hurry. So out on the floor, John and Rick Davidson. That's Rick Davidson trying to get in, or at least making a show of trying to get in, while Chavo Guerrero and Mr. Olympia wait impatiently. So John is the man in the ring, and Mr. Olympia, big men, the Davidson brothers, but so is Mr. Olympia. Crotch hold, a lift, and a slam, and the team of Mr. Olympia and Chavo Guerrero take over, and in an orderly fashion. They may not have started with the explosion, but they sure have taken control of the explosive possibilities of their own style. Rick Davidson after a legal touch, and Chavo Guerrero goes after a hammerlock, then turns it into a twisting arm lock, and here is quick movement by the team of Olympia and Chavo Guerrero. Chavo Guerrero, son of a wrestler, and another one of the newer breed that has been wrestling since they're old enough to walk. Chavo was great as an amateur and is great, even greater as a professional. There's the touch. In comes young Chavo. And he found his mark, and Rick Davidson has an arm bar applied to that same arm on which Chavo Guerrero landed. Referee asking the all-important question, do you quit or not? And you better find the answer if the arm is in danger. There's the Chavo Guerrero with one of his always crowd-pleasing moves. And here's a boy who is always thinking and is always looking ahead. And he invents moves to fit the situation. The argument, I don't know what the argument could be about, but all I can say is that as Chavo goes outside, he's not content merely to stand in the corner, and as he leans on that rope, he tries to make it difficult for, and he did. He made it almost impossible for John to get in there and help his brother Rick. So John's on the outside, and as Chavo tries to rip that arm right out of the socket, if it were possible, but he surely can do it a lot of damage, and that's the purpose of taking an arm lock, is to make the muscles weary and to force your opponent to not only lose his ability to use the arm, but most certainly to use his, lose his willingness to fight. So Mr. Olympia keeps maneuvering, keeps the arm under control, and the Davidson brothers are in trouble. Olympia, a fine athlete, well-built individual, man who is obviously in top physical condition. As he drops in there, he lands with his knees on the upper part of the arm, mostly on the tricep muscle, giving Rick Davidson something to think about if he intends to make use of the arm throughout the rest of the match.
The clock is winding on down. We have less than a minute remaining, so I know we'd be disappointed. They're all both teams if they don't come out with a victory one way or the other. We want to remind the fans that next week, the big Kamala, the Ugandan warrior, will be here on Mid-South Wrestling. Also, the Louisiana Heavyweight Championship on the line as Hacksaw Jim Duggan defends against the challenge of Mr. USA Tony Atlas. Tag team action sees Mr. Wrestling 2 and Stagger Lee join forces against Ted DiBiase and Matt Bourne. That's coming up next week. As action continues now, it's winding down, almost time for the watch. Look, a tremendous dive over the rope by Chavo Guerrero just in time.
And we've got a fall.
Our fall and gains the victory in tag team match. As our time's about gone, thank you so much, Paul Bosch, for a tremendous job and description of professional wrestling at its very best. Till next week, folks, Boyd Pearson. Goodbye, everybody, from Mid-South Wrestling Television Network. Hello, everybody, and welcome to this week's edition of Mid-South Wrestling Television. I'm your host, Boyd Pearson, and as usual, lots of exciting action. Popper Chavo Guerrero is here. The big Ugandan warrior, Kamala, will be on this week's card. It'll be headlined by a Louisiana Heavyweight Championship match as Hacksaw Jim Duggan defends his coveted title and belt against the challenge of the man from Roanoke, Virginia, Mr. USA, Tony Atlas. Tag team action, a non-title bout. It'll be Matt Bourne and Ted DiBiase, the Mid-South Tag Team title holders, against Mr. Wrestling 2 and Stagger Lee. Also, Mr. Olympia is here against gorgeous Gino Hernandez. Lots of great action. The man to my left, who needs no introduction to Mid-South fans, whether it's in the ring or out, Cowboy Bill Watts, our guest commentator.
Well, boy, it should be an exciting evening. Some great bouts. Tony Atlas and Hacksaw Duggan for that Louisiana title, and of course, the non-title tag match. And later on, Paul Bosch, the preeminent promoter from Houston, Texas, and great commentator, a man who's been in broadcasting for 50 years, will join you here. But gives me a lot of pleasure to be back here, and I'm kind of a spokesman right now for Mr. Wrestling, too. People have been noticing how nervous and edgy and upset he is. He's made a couple of comments in the ring, but this is the type of thing that's been going on for Wrestling, too, this mental mind game, this defiling of similar equipment to his. Somebody has copied his equipment and they're defiling it. It's almost like a voodoo type thing or a witch doctor type thing. And you can see here it said, Mr. Two, have a good hard look and remember when. Something out of his past. And of course they've taken this mannequin, covered it with a mask similar to Wrestling Two's, wrapped it in gauze with the crimson in front signifying a bad injury. So this is what has got Wrestling 2 so upset. He doesn't know the direction, the input, or the thrust, or who it is. And I just want to say that it's really low for somebody to have to stoop like this. This is supposed to be a man's business, where if you've got a beef with somebody, you step out and you take them on one-on-one and settle it. And whoever it is, be warned, and also come on out and state your case right here with Grizzly Smith. He'll put you right in the ring with Wrestling 2, and you can do whatever you're man enough to do.
And the first match is in the ring. Let's go for the introduction and Reeser Bowden.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 250 pounds from Rome, Georgia, Marty Lundy. And in the blue corner at 235 pounds from Mexico, Chavo Guerrero.
In the black tights, Marty Lundy, and shedding his colorful jacket, the high-flying popper, Chavo Guerrero. Alfred Neely calls for the bell. Action underway. Here's Bill Watts.
Chavo Guerrero, an exciting star, a man that, although smaller in stature, he conducts himself in the ring as a super heavyweight. He has that power and that balance. He has that tremendous punching power. If he gets in a fight, he's got the wrestling skills. You know, Eric Weiss, who was a national champion from Oklahoma State University, and he's ranked about number 3 in the world in freestyle, I once asked him what he patterned his wrestling after, and he said when he's a youngster, he's now a 190-pounder, and he weighs about 225 off-season. He said he watched the smaller guys, and he figured in order to be great to be a big man, you had to wrestle like a small man. Well, here's Chavo Guerrero with all that ability of the small man, the quickness, the lightning speed, the reflexes, but he's got that inherent power. Something like a Danny Hodge. You all remember Danny Hodge, the great world's junior heavyweight champion. And even though he only weighed 220, he could take the measure of any man he ever got in the ring with. And this Chavo Guerrero seems to be cut in the same vein. An unusual match coming up, Boyd, and we'll be revealing it as we go on. As Lester Parks is going to wrestle Kamala, the Ugandan warrior that's now leased by Skandar Akbar. But Akbar has paid this man, Lester Parks, a bonus, to wear a mask in that match. And in talking to Skandar Akbar, I said, that's a little bit ridiculous. Everybody knows who Lester Parks is. He said, that has nothing to do with it. He said, when you have a savage like Kamala, small things mean a lot to him. He likes to, not, beating a man is not the most important thing. He wants something to show him the victory. He said, I've got this man putting his mask on, and I've told Kamala if he beats him, he can tear the mask off. Well, you can feel, figure Akbar to come out with some devious, diabolical plan in order to train this big savage, go after the mask. And we know it could be the mask of Stagger Lee, because I'm sure Ted DiBiase has offered a ton of money to reveal Stagger Lee's identity to force a forfeit on the North American title. Or could it be Wrestling 2's mask? Or Mr. Olympia's mask? Marty Lundy going for the big score on Chavo Guerrero, but Chavo moved quickly, get out of the way, rolling to give himself time to clear his head. Oftentimes you'll see a fighter in the ring just trying to box himself out of a little trouble by moving away. Well, Chavo Guerrero put some distance between him when Marty Lundy came in, a drop kick rather low, right into the solar plexus. A very well-devised drop kick, because your solar plexus can sure take the wind out of you, and these big, powerful bodies are just machines that run on oxygen. And if you don't have any oxygen, just like being out of gasoline, you can't, no go. And Chavo Guerrero showing that unique style. Marty Lundy to the floor. Chavo springing over the top rope, right on top of Marty Lundy, just wiped him out. Clear over the top rope, clear to the floor. This man is excitement personified. Has wrestled all over the world. He and Mil Máscaras, the two top Mexican stars in the world. Another drop kick. I tell you, if you were against Chavo Guerrero, you'd get tired of getting up, because wherever you are, he's going to put you down, and it's a different way. And an inside cradle, and he's got the fall.
Tremendous maneuvers by Chavo Guerrero. We'll be back. More action coming up on Mid-South Wrestling Television Network.
This event is for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the blue corner at 238 pounds from Kingston, Jamaica, Lester Parks. And at 385 pounds, now under the management of General Skandar Akbar, Kamala, the Ugandan warrior.
And the ring filled up quickly. Lester Parks there first, and then his opponent, the Ugandan warrior Kamala, and then the manager, General Skandar Akbar, and there's his man Friday, his handler. So Bill Watts, action will get underway very shortly, just as soon as he can remove the thing. Various things that he wears.
Boy, I want to bring out, did you see on the spear, he's got the last mask of his last mask victim on the spear. It's almost like an Indian scalp lock, where it's a trophy for Kamala. And you can count on Akbar again with a diabolical plan, diabolical in its simplicity. He has bonused Lester Parks to wear a mask. And he has promised Kamala that if he beats Lester Parks, he can have Lester Parks' mask. Kamala, surprisingly agile for his bulk, gets across the ring as fast as any lineman in the National Football League. He's over there quick, and he is really carrying the attack, and he seems to be loving the added bonus that he gets of that big mask if he beats the guy. Almost childlike in his simplicity. Look at him chop, and just he's just overpowering Lester Parks. Kamala, the Ugandan warrior. If you ever saw a pointed threat at Stagger Lee and at Mr. Wrestling 2 and Mr. Olympia, you're seeing it now, this big, awesome 385-pound man, tremendous agility. Rolls the man over. That's when he delivers that coup de grace, that 385. Look at the elevation and the distance he gets as he leaps and crushes the man to the mat. and that's taken all the wind out of Lester Parks, and Lester Parks becomes another victim to Kamala, the Ugandan warrior. Now, Boyd, let's stay with it. Oral Link, and you can see the fiendish glee. Skandar Akbar and whoever that man is in the jungle outfit, the camouflage of the pith helmet and his own mask. And look at Kamala joyfully putting it on there, just like I say, it's like a coup stick or a trophy stick. And he's very, very happy with it. And Skandar Akbar has again designed a method to his madness.
He's happy as a child finding a treasured toy on Christmas. Kamala the Giant will be back. Tag team action after this message.
It's tag team action now in a non-title event for one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner, the Mid-South Tag Team Champions at 268 pounds from Omaha, Nebraska, Ted DiBiase. And his partner at 240 pounds from Atlanta, Georgia, Matt Bourne. And there's champions everywhere. At 236 pounds, the Mississippi heavyweight champion, Mr. Wrestling 2. And at 265 pounds, the North American heavyweight champion, Stagger Lee.
An untitled match, Ted DiBiase and Matt Bourne against Stagger Lee and Mr. Wrestling 2, Bill.
My boy Pierce, it's hot and heavy out there. The crowd is really, DiBiase and Bourne have attracted a crowd. Before their opponents came out, they were hollering, Freebirds, Freebirds, Freebirds. Everybody knows the run-in DiBiase has had with the Freebirds and Michael Hayes, Terry Gordy, and Buddy Roberts. And then when Mr. Wrestling 2 and Stagger Lee came out, the crowd really went wild, hollering, 2, 2, 2, and the music of Stagger Lee brought them all to its feet. And, of course, there's just a little less than a month left in the period of time that DiBiase has to get Stagger Lee's mask off to reveal whether or not it's the junkyard dog under there, because if he can get that mask off, and it is the junkyard dog, the North American title that's carried by Stagger Lee, who he won in the Superdome on Thanksgiving night, and you were there, Boyd, with your back to the ring at a very crucial moment, and I can't say that I blame you, then the title would be forfeited back to DiBiase, and the junkyard dog would be suspended from Mid-South for 1 year. But right now, it's all in the ring. Non-title match, a very important bout. Could be a dynamite team, a tremendous team. Stagger Lee, the rugged ruffian who claims no formal education, claims he spent a lot of time in a place where there's not a lot of sunshine, making license plates. But one thing he also claims is he's the only man that ever whipped the junkyard dog. Used to take his milk money on the way to school, and the dog, when he lost and had to leave Mid-South for 90 days, he called Stagger Lee to come here and take care of DiBiase. Stagger Lee has come and he's gotten right into the conflict, not only of DiBiase, Bourne, Dugan, but Kamala, the Ugandan warrior. But now he's teamed with a man who will ask no quarter, give none, a rough, rugged, mysterious individual, a man upset by somebody defiling his equipment or similar equipment, almost in a voodoo-like spell, trying to cast a hex on him or try to confuse him and make him wonder which direction his next attacker's coming from. It could be one of those men out there in the audience in that ring right now. It could be DiBiase, it could be Bourne, it could be Dugan, it could be Akbar, the way he seems to have the big Ugandan incensed with gaining a victory to get a mask to add to his trophy stick. Very tribal, very basic. Fantastic team. If this team could beat DiBiase and Bourne right here today on TV, I'm sure Grizzly Smith, the opportune matchmaker that he is, would jump right on it and force this into a Mid-South title match. Oh, connected with that knee. Wrestling too, he can hit you with that knee lift at any time, any place. Paul Bosch said something very key. Many men can use a knee lift, but few men have perfected it. Many men can throw a right hand, but few men can throw it like Joe Louis or Rocky Marciano. It's all in the technique, the speed, the timing. And wrestling, too, can decapitate you. I promise you this. Oh, there's a man that just decapitated somebody as Matt Bourne just got clotheslined by Stagger Lee. I'll tell you this. If wrestling, too, connects even with somebody like Kamala the Giant, if you kill the head, you kill the body, is an old saying in boxing. And I'll promise you that if he whacks Kamala with enough of those impact dynamite knees, even Kamala will go down. Stagger Lee showing that tremendous power. And the crowd is loving it. Look at them all holding up number one. Number one, DiBiase's kiss can't stand it. He comes firing in, trying to get to Stagger Lee. Wrestling 2 shows another use for his knee as DiBiase gets his face rearranged. Tony Atlas versus Hacksaw Dugan for the Louisiana title next. A big day on Mid-South Wrestling. That's why Mid-South Wrestling is the number one spectator sports event on your TV in every market that it's in. And we want to thank you fans for having us in. And this is one of the reasons Grizzly Smith has matches like this right here on television for everybody to enjoy. Matt Bourne firing away and starting to get on too, and you hear the crowd going two, 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 two. It's like his rallying cry, and I want you to know that it can affect you. It can make you, your adrenaline get to flowing. It can help you when the people are pulling for you. DiBiase in firing away on Wrestling 2. Wrestling 2, a man that's known for not having a lot of control of his temper. He's an intense individual. And it seems like it just kind of a slow boil under that surface at all moments. And one thing that can really get it to come uncorked is somebody messing with his mask. Oh, look at him deliver those forearm smashes. And he gets the tag to Stagger Lee. Stagger Lee's in the ring. Matt Bourne, Stagger Lee and Matt Bourne legally in the ring, but DiBiase's in. All four of them are in. Referee Ralph Neely having a hard time containing it. You can understand why. Double clothesline. Matt Bourne's on the floor. Referee Neely putting two out. The crowd's hollering, warning Ralph Neely that Bourne, Neely caught him. Neely caught him and made him get off the top rope. That would have been illegal, but now DiBiase is going for Stagger Lee's mask, but wrestling to decapitated him with that devastating knee lift. Now he's got a, he's illegal in the ring. Bourne came from the top rope, but the but almost slipped to Stagger Lee, caught him a right. A victory for the team of Stagger Lee and Mr. Wrestling 2. A convincing, resounding, the people to their feet. Boy, Pierce, a great bout. Listen, 2-2-2.
Tremendous.
And Stagger Lee.
And coming up next, the Louisiana heavyweight title, Hacksaw Dugan, defending against Mr. USA Tony Atlas after this important word.
And now a title match for the Louisiana Heavyweight Championship. This
Let
event.
Let me say one thing. Hacksaw Dugan, the thing about you, brother, you need to learn some respect. Now you come out here and you talk about a lot of people and you say you got the dog down. Well, I'm going to do one thing, brother. I come down here to whoop you for JYD. So every time I punch you in them big old lips of yours, you think about JYD.
Tell you something, Atlas. Hacksaw Duggan's not a hard man to find. I'm right here in this ring right now, and I think all them big puff muscles you got on your arm are nothing but garbage, and I know that this big
chair. Is this for that belt? Is this for that belt?
It is.
Well, I don't mean no harm or nothing, sir, but will you please just move on out the way?
Now you have it. Tony Atlas getting a shot at the Louisiana Heavyweight Championship belt.
Well, the formalities are over, Boyd. You've heard of them staring each other down in the ring. These guys, they are just flat telling each other. And here comes two immovable objects, two rough, rugged guys. This is the only man I've ever seen that's taken the spear of Hacksaw Dugan and come out better is Mr. USA Tony Atlas, a man we saw bench press 550 pounds. Right here on television. When you compare it, 240 pounds against Dave Remington, the two-time Outland Trophy winner, the All-American center from Nebraska, who can only bench press 485. You see the caliber of athlete. They're going to arm wrestle. They're going to arm wrestle, Boyd Pierce, a personal challenge for pride. They're going for pride as well as the Louisiana title. People are chanting J.Y.D. Tony Adams says he's down here for his friend, who Hacksaw Dugan in the gorilla suit made a fool of. Look at Atlas. He's putting Hacksaw's arm down just like he wasn't even there to show you that power. And Dugan is a man, like he says, he has no regard for his own personal safety. He's like a one-man gang. He's turned many a barroom into a parking lot as he's stomped some people around, and he's the battling dude, All-American at SMU, kicked out of the National Football League for refusing to obey the spear rule, and he's after Mr. USA Tony Adams. This just had to happen. This has to be settled among these two men with the Louisiana, the coveted Louisiana title at stake. Tony Adams putting that big ham bone right up against him, showing that he's got some moves. He's got some moves, Tony Adams. He can boogie. Exciting young athlete, and Hacksaw Dugan finding out Tony Atlas just how powerful he's headed. And Dugan's getting a little bit scattered here. And Tony is really whacking him. And Hacksaw is down on the floor. Hacksaw trying to collect these wits. Hacksaw trying to collect these wits. DiBiase out there. Matt Bourne calling for time. DiBiase with a towel, wiping the sweat off of Hacksaw, trying to re-gear him there. Ricky Ferrara wants to see what's in that towel. That's smart referees checking out that towel. Tony Atlas keeping on. Matt Bourne sneaking up from behind, but Tony Atlas has caught him. Atlas caught him and his headbutt him. DiBiase in a protest. Atlas pulled DiBiase into the ring. He has forced DiBiase into the ring. And Atlas is whipping him. Ricky Ferrara got caught in the way. What's Hacksaw Dugan over there sneaking in? Hacksaw Dugan sneaking in as Atlas. Hacksaw Dugan putting on something. Hacksaw putting on something. And he speared Tony Atlas. Hacksaw Dugan has speared Tony Atlas. Something came flying off his head. He's putting his tights. He's got Tony Atlas down. And referee Rick Ferrara making the count. Hacksaw Dugan winning this match. The Rat Pack. The Rat Pack.
Backville, Olympia versus Arnett. Settle here after.
This event is for one fall or remaining television time. In the red corner at 235 pounds from Houston, Texas, gorgeous Gino Hernandez. And in the blue corner at 243 pounds, Mr. Olympia.
Things trying to settle down here after weird and wild action on the match between Mr. Racing 2 and Stagger Lee against Ted DiBiase and Matt Bourne. And then it followed up by the Louisiana Heavyweight Championship. Tony Atlas and Hacksaw Dugan proving once again professional wrestling is the world's most exciting professional sport. Here to tell you about it, 34 years consecutive on television, the Dean of Commentators, Paul Bosch.
Well, right up in the ring, I think we've got the makings of some more excitement with gorgeous Gino Hernandez and the man in the mask, Mr. Olympia. Certainly, each has its own style and each has its own reputation, and this means a lot in the careers of both men. Mr. Olympia looking for a little support from the crowd, and he gets it. Gorgeous Gino rarely looks for support from the crowd because he has been disappointed too many times. As a matter of fact, that's what made him sore against audiences, because he wanted them to support the manner in which he wrestled, and they didn't do it. So he decided that he was going to wrestle in a way that wouldn't need support from fans. And right now he's caught in a headlock because of his principles. But the swift movement there and the change of holds was due to the smooth movement of Mr. Olympia. Good man. He knows his way around on the mat, and he has a style that's a little hard to fathom, the strength to back it up. Gorgeous Gino arm drag, and he takes a reverse arm bar on that hold, and on that arm rather, and cinches it down. And we've got exchanges here that show that each man is not only on the offensive, but when he escapes from a hold, he comes up with his own grip, and this is the sign of the true professional, when he can prepare for one situation when he's caught in another. So Gino now is getting a lecture from the referee on staying closer to the center of the ring than the ropes. But Gino knows the ropes. In his career, the ropes have been his friend many times. Little test of strength, the locking of the fingers. This is a test of balance and wanting to see just what your opponent is willing to submit to. And up on the top rope comes Mr. Olympia. And nice move, and he come off that top rope. Now, you got to remember that the rules say you can't come off the top rope on top of your opponent. In this case, he went up on the top rope to do something more than just come down and land on a prostrate opponent. Twisting arm lock, there's the turn. And Gino decides that once again, the ropes will be his friend. They've matched each other hold for hold in this, which is not always entirely Gino's style. That's better, more Gino's style. It's better to catch his opponent with an opening and to drive at it with everything he has. And to drive his opponent against everything he can find, too. And here now as he uncorks here, and now he's asking the fans why they don't come up and support him. They came up, but with a few epithets that will best be forgotten. Off on the cold concrete is Mr. Olympia. He sailed through the ropes and was unable to break his fall in any way. He came down there with a crash on the small strip of concrete in between the ring and the first row of seats. So Olympia starts back in, and it's a grim prospect, because when you've hit that, here's another one, and oh, man. There was a whirling fall that can literally spin you around and land you with a crash in a manner that you can't protect yourself. So Mr. Olympia trying his best now to listen to the referee and to spring up there so that he can get into the ring and in better condition than he went out. Gino, impatient, anxious, ready to move, and he caught one. Driving wallops, and Gino in that bent over position is in no condition to return the fire. And there's returning the fire, the man with a mask up where he can pound down on the helpless head of Gino Hernandez. The crash, and that was a solid, sickening crash. He hit with his neck, his shoulder, and his head almost all at the same time. Mr. Olympia draped across the ropes, and Gino is the kind of a man who can make the most of a situation like that. Back of the elbow, and he wants that fast count, but he didn't get it. He wants that referee to count a little faster than the referee is accustomed to count. And as he sets Olympia up again, he's ready for it, and no, Mr. Olympia is not ready, and he's got him wrapped up in a small package. He rolls him up tight and almost made it. The long legs of Gino Hernandez were the key to breaking that hold, and the two count was evident. God, that was a crash. Olympia was off his feet when he went into Gino Hernandez. He was driving for that rope and hit Gino like the proverbial ton of bricks. When you first rule of wrestling is make sure of your target before you leave your feet. So Olympia comes up, he goes for the backslide, and he slides him down. There's one and there's two, and the referee caught the brunt of Gino's weight that time. And now it's Olympia looking for the setup, but there's a quick switch, and look at that man dive through the air, and there is one, and there is two, and there it was close. some great exchanges between these two here. And a sleep hold as Mr. Olympia puts the arm around the neck and looks for the proper place to apply the pressure on the carotid artery. And Gino had other things in mind. He drove into the turnbuckle. The masked man went over Gino's back into the ring post and down to the floor. And now, as the referee counts, we could have a count out in this. And Gino is stunned, trying to recover from the sleep hold and trying now to bring Mr. Olympia into the ring. Oh, man, he hit with his head first that time. That was a bad fall. And Gino's legs are out of the ring. The referee arguing with him. And now with Olympia in the ring, Gino comes off to land with his weight again, a move that has become his trademark. And he scores a win over a man who is capable of winning many matches and does.
Gino Hernandez, every time it seems like we say he gains another victory, this time over the highly ranked Mr. Olympia. Tag team action coming up after this message.
It's tag team action now for one fall or remaining television time. In the red corner, at a total combined weight of 513 pounds from Fort Worth, Texas, the Davidson brothers, John and Rick Davidson. And in the blue corner, at 278 pounds from Hamilton, Ontario, Canada, Iron Mike Sharp. And his partner at 222 pounds from Knoxville, Tennessee, Tim Horner.
Well, there's the introduction of the tag team match. As Rick Ferreira says, give me one man from each team before the match starts. But I have a message that has just come down from the wrestling office. The matchmaker has said next week he has made it official. It's all back where it started, because next week the contestants that was in this week's Wild Melee in a non-title match, Mr. Wrestling 2 and Stagger Lee versus Ted DiBiase and Matt Bourne. But next week it'll be for the Mid-South Tag Team title, a championship on the line, one fall, no disqualification, and, Paul, the loser of the fall must leave the Mid-South area. So it's back where it started. At one time, it's Ted DiBiase and Matt Bourne against Mr. Wrestling 2 and the Junkyard Dog. For that next week, it'll be Mr. Wrestling 2 and Stagger Lee. Right now, tag team.
You did say right here on television.
Exactly.
And up in the ring, it is Rick Davidson, who has just been knocked down by Iron Mike Sharp. But that was great news, Boyd Pierce, and I know fans will be pulling up their chairs and leaving them in front of the television set for next week. Tim Horner in there as he takes Rick Davidson down, side headlock the hold, and the team of Iron Mike Sharp and Tim Horner have their work cut out for them. The brothers are big, they are rugged, and as John comes into the ring, John Davidson, there is a headlock greeting for him, but Tim Horner has got to put that hold to work for sure. He does. A nice shoulder butt and a drive into his opponent. He took a chance that time coming in straight up, but he takes that side headlock and puts Davidson down where he can do something about it. Side headlock applied with plenty of enthusiasm by Tim Horner, the kind of a hold that makes your opponent weary from either carrying you around or makes him groggy from just plain squeezing his head and giving his brain something to worry about. Quick move and a quick switch, and the hip lock worked. So Tim Horner is maneuvering Davidson around. Horner down.
Paul, this is tag team action, but we want to remind the fans listening, next week, tag team action for the Mid-South champion. Ted DiBiase and Matt Bourne against Mr. Wrestling 2 and Stagger Lee next week.
On television.
Right here on Mid-South.
Right. And that's big Ben Mike Sharp as he maneuvers in the ring and throws a dropkick. He's a big man for it. But these are big people, and you've got to get up high for the dropkick. We've got three men in the ring, two Davidsons and Mike Sharp. And we've got a fall.
As the winner, hand raised by Rick Pereira, Mike Sharp, and Tim Horner over the Davidsons. We have action coming up after this important message.
This event is for one fall or remaining television time. In the red corner at 268 pounds from Vancouver, British Columbia, Kelly Koniski. And in the blue corner at 238 pounds from Richmond, Virginia, Buddy Landell.
Buddy Landell in the red trunks against Vancouver, British Columbia's pride and joy. In the blue tights, Kelly Koniski, son of the former world heavyweight champion Gene Koniski, which you and I, Paul, know very, very well.
That's right. And I guess that sometimes it's a handicap to have that tacked onto your name. Every time Kelly Koniski is introduced, the announcer, either in the ring or out, says, son of the former world champion Gene Koniski. That puts the onus on Kelly Koniski to emulate his father, and he hopes to do that someday. He's a very serious-minded young man. He's a rugged customer. But then nobody ever accused his father of raising a sissy, I can tell you that. So in the blue trunks, it's Kelly Koniski, and in the red trunks, Buddy Landell, a rare hunk of the young segment of the population in wrestling today, and they are fine examples of it. So Hammerlock, as Buddy Landell swings around underneath and escapes and comes up with a hold of his own. Kelly nose down in the canvas, knows that's a bad place to be, but with that arm up his back, he's got to worry about saving that arm and keeping from losing the match at the same time.
Kelly's big news, Paul.
Yes.
Next week, right here on television, it's signed, it's official, Mr. Wrestling 2 and Stagger Lee versus Ted DiBiase and Matt Bourne. The Mid-South Tag Team Championship will be at stake. It'll be one fall, no disqualification, and the loser of that fall must leave the Mid-South area. So I'm looking forward to that one. We still have action here, but I'm just gazing ahead. I tell you, it gets greater every week.
It surely does, yes. And as up in the ring, we'll settle down to Kelly Koniski and Buddy Landell. Hard to find a better-looking athlete than Buddy Landell, and yet we've had them on this program tonight. People like Mr. Olympia, we've had Mr. Tony Atlas, than whom there is no finer-looking athlete, but all of these people are men who are product of hard, hard physical labor in gymnasiums, in other sports, and in wrestling itself. So it's an armbar for Kelly Koniski as they fight for supremacy here. He snaked up there and got those legs around his head, and head scissor is the result. Koniski trying to get out without leaving an ear behind. And as he goes into that headstand, he tried to get his weight centered over the body of Buddy Landell so that he could get the shoulders down, even though he was caught in the head scissor, but it didn't work out that way. So there's a count of one, and Kelly came down with his knee across that good-looking face of Buddy Landell. So it's possible that the face has been rearranged. Setting him up, catching him with that slash of the hand, and Buddy Landell is up fast. Cartwheel slam, and Landell is on top. There's one, there's two, and these two youngsters now, as they spin into top speed, exchanged holds, and Buddy Landell is bleeding from, I believe he's bleeding from a cut just in the eyebrow and alongside of his eye. I hope not, but I got a glimpse of it, and he was reaching up there with his hand in a manner that made me think that it was cut open. It may be a bruise. And here again, the quick exchange of efforts to pin, and Kelly having, rather, Buddy having his trouble with that eye, which has been hit with Kelly Koniski's knee and is bothering him considerably. Side headlock. And the efforts of Kelly Koniski to come out revolve around, just spinning around and taking the arm with him, but he didn't get very far. And again, there's give, there's take, and there is a grueling effort to overcome the opposition. Side headlock again. And
Paul, as we have 1 minute time remaining, 1 minute on this week's edition of Mid-South Wrestling. There they go, trying to gain a pinfall under the wire. But remember, next week here on Mid-South Wrestling, right on television, the Mid-South Tag Team Championship, it's official, it's sanctioned, will be one fall. There's no disqualification. The loser of the fall must leave the Mid-South area. And the contestants, Mr. Racing 2 and Stagger Lee versus Ted DiBiase and Matt Bourne. It all adds up to an hour's of exciting action, just like we've had this week. And whenever we're in the arenas, wherever you are, never miss professional wrestling. Time is running out as they continue for our guest commentators' earlier matches of Cowboy Bill Watts, followed up by the expert golden throat of Paul Bosch, the impresario of Houston Wrestling. I'm your host, Boyd Pearson. Goodbye, everybody, from Mid-South Wrestling.